Good afternoon, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. A very warm welcome to all of you. This 53rd edition of the Munich Security Conference promises to be the most anticipated Munich Security Conference in many years. There is massive uncertainty, including, in particular, also about the future of the transatlantic relationship. European leaders, European governments, and others are extremely impatient to find out what will really drive US foreign policy in this new period.
It's a legacy of freedom, it's a legacy of friendship, and a trusted alliance. With the ingrained respect that two democracies share for each other, and the trust we share with 26 other democracies in the NATO alliance, and Article 5 is a bedrock commitment. American security is permanently tied to the security of Europe. Done correctly, European initiatives and NATO unity are mutually reinforcing.
Es hat sehr gut getan zu hören, wie klar das Bekenntnis des amerikanischen Verteidigungsministers zum transatlantischen Bündnis, zum transatlantischen Band ist. Umgekehrt wissen unsere amerikanischen Freunde gut, dass ihr Ton zu Europa und zur NATO einen direkten Einfluss auf den Zusammenhalt unseres Kontinents hat. Eine stabile Europäische Union ist deshalb genauso im amerikanischen Interesse wie eine geschlossene NATO.
The role of Germany is always to bridge the gap between South and North and East and West.
But can we, once again, respect our own constitution?
Please do. That's all we ask as Commission. Yes. Respect your own constitution.
Please allow us to respect our own constitution.
Yes.
Not your vision of our constitution.
No.
Okay?
Absolutely.
Not your vision of our constitution.
Our destiny is based on our values, not on a currency, not on a market.
It turns out, peace is a most meaningless word without the institutions to make it real.
In the four decades I have attended this conference, I cannot recall a year where its purpose was more necessary or more important.
My message is very simple. Nothing about Ukraine without Ukraine. Any deal with Putin behind Ukraine would only aggravate the situation.
Give these guys and give Donald Trump a chance. Give Donald, yes, it's a new style of government, but don't underrate the capacity for a new approach to deliver results.
Make no mistake, my friends, these are dangerous times, but you should not count America out. As long as people of goodwill and courage refuse to lose faith in the West, it will endure. I am a proud, unapologetic believer in the West. I believe we must always, always stand up for it. For if we do not, who will? Thank you.
Thank you. Deutschland hat sich wie alle anderen Staaten auf der NATO-Konferenz in Wales verpflichtet, das war 2014, binnen 10 Jahren das 2%-Ziel zu erreichen. Und ich darf hier genauso wie die Verteidigungsministerin sagen, wir werden alle Anstrengungen übernehmen. Wir fühlen uns diesem Ziel verpflichtet.
But today, on behalf of President Trump, I bring you this assurance. The United States of America strongly supports NATO and will be unwavering in our commitment to this transatlantic alliance. The promise to share the burden of our defense has gone unfulfilled for too many, for too long, and it erodes the very foundation of our alliance. As of this moment, the United States and only 4 other NATO members meet this basic standard. The President of the United States expects our allies to keep their word, to fulfill this commitment, and for most, that means the time has come to do more.
The post-war generation rose to their challenge. Now we must rise to ours. Because a strong Europe cannot mean Europe alone. Just as I don't believe America first means America alone.
We understand that Minsk agreements are dead. What's your opinion about that and where do we take it from here?
Das Minsker Abkommen ist das Einzige, was wir im Augenblick haben, um den Gesprächsfaden und die Möglichkeit der Lösung der Probleme voranzubringen. Und ich bin dagegen, dass man, wenn man nichts anderes hat, etwas wegwirft, was vielleicht immer noch Hoffnung mit sich bringt. Nichts wäre uns lieber, wenn wir mit Russland gemeinsam gegen den islamistischen Terror kämpfen könnten, wenn wir mit Russland wieder vernünftige Handelsbeziehungen aufbauen könnten, wenn wir an einer Freihandelszone von Vladivostok bis Lissabon arbeiten könnten. Aber das Prinzip der territorialen Integrität, das können wir nicht aufgeben. Das sind wir nicht nur der Ukraine schuldig, sondern das sind wir vielen, vielen anderen Ländern und uns allen selbst schuldig.
The United States will continue to hold Russia accountable. Even as we search for new common ground, which, as you know, President Trump believes can be found.
Отношения со всеми странами, в первую очередь с нашими соседями, всегда были присущи нашей внешней политике. И украинского конфликта, выполнению Минского комплекса мер через прямой диалог Киева с Донецком и Луганском нет альтернативы. Это твердая позиция и России, и Запада, и Совета Безопасности ООН.
I think peace is only possible when none of the parties to the conflict think they can win. I'm not sure we are yet there in Syria. I'm afraid that some might still think, and I think it's a total illusion, that they might win that war.
Das heißt, die Europäische Union muss lernen, sich mehr zu konzentrieren auf die wirklich wichtigen Herausforderungen, Wettbewerbsfähigkeit, Arbeitsplätze, innere Sicherheit, äußere Sicherheit.
The European Union is much, much stronger than we Europeans realize, and it's much more indispensable to Europeans and to the world than we realize most of the times. It's not charity. Investing in development, investing in the Sustainable Development Goals, investing in humanitarian is not charity. Is an investment, a selfish investment in our own security.
Eh bien, le multilatéralisme est l'antidote au nationalisme.
Was heißt das jetzt für uns Europäer? Mein Rat ist, optimistisch zu bleiben, aber eben nicht unvorbereitet. Ein bisschen nach dem Motto, hoping for the best, preparing for the worst. Unseren europäischen Partnern jedenfalls können wir versichern, in Abwandlung eines Zitats von Mario Draghi, whatever it takes. Deutschland wird alles tun, damit Europa sich nicht spalten lässt.
is that we ignore the strong link between health security and international security at our peril. So we need a new arsenal of weapons. These are antiviral drugs, antibodies, vaccines, and new diagnostics. Finally, we need to prepare for these epidemics the same way that we prepare for war. It includes simulations, so-called germ games, and other preparedness exercises so we can understand better how disease will spread, how people will respond, and how to deal with the overloaded highways and communication systems. We can be quite prepared for a lethal epidemic within the next 10 years. It'll cost a fraction of what we spend on defense and new weapon systems, and in fact, we can share a lot of these investments.
And we have forgotten how catastrophic those epidemics have been in our history.
Underlying all of that, though, I think is this issue of fragile states and fragile contexts. We need to address health systems in these countries, otherwise we're going to be in a perpetual cycle of trying to firefight.
Resources are very necessary, they are very critical. But we should also, therefore, fix these issues so that it's not about throwing money at something, at a problem. It's about understanding how to deploy these resources and whether they are going to be used effectively to give us the results we want, so that we don't keep repeating the same mistakes.
One of President Trump's executive orders was designed as a temporary pause that would allow us, in many ways allow me, to see where our immigration and refugee vetting system has gaps, and gaps it has, that could be exploited. The president is contemplating releasing a tighter, more streamlined version of the first DO, and we will have I will have opportunity to work a rollout plan.
Die letzten zwei Jahre waren, wenn Sie so wollen, Jahre europäischer Opfer und Jahre europäischer Entscheidungen. Die nächsten zwei, drei Jahre sind Jahre europäischer Umsetzung. We need to share more intelligence within Europe, but I don't see a political majority and I don't see the will of the big countries to create something like a new body, a European body for intelligence.
As long as a distinction between good and bad terrorism is maintained, we are all losers.
Terrorism and Daesh are the enemies of the Muslims first.
Meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren, Exzellenzen, ich begrüße die anwesenden Staats- und Regierungschefs und hochrangigen Repräsentanten aus aller Welt auf das Allerherzlichste hier im Kaisersaal der Münchner Residenz.
I'm extremely happy to announce that the recipient of this year's Ewald von Kleist Award is the head of state of Germany, President Joachim Gauck. He has been a wonderful champion of freedom and of a liberal international order. That's all the good news. The bad news is that President Gauck, who until yesterday was looking forward to being here with us tonight, he has fallen ill. The head of his presidential office, Staatssekretär David Gill, will receive the award.
There is plenty of work for us all in keeping our societies and our common Europe together. I believe and hope that we all will continue to benefit from his invaluable contributions to the defense of democracy. I will salute, dear Joachim, you, and wish you the best of health.
Thank you.
Russia attempted to swing the United States election for one candidate. They have thus far paid very little price for that interference. And, you know, there is a unique role that the United States Congress can play here.
If you're worried that we're not going to look long and hard at what Russia did in our election because Trump won and Republicans in charge, you don't need to worry about that. We are. Because if we don't, it could be the Chinese and the Iranians next. It could be Republicans next time. So I'm with Sheldon, Senator McCain's leading the charge on armed services, and we have a good working team and intel. I promise everybody in this room that Congress is going to take a long, hard look at what Russia did to undermine our elections, so you'll be better prepared when they come your way.
Efforts on the part of a president to undermine and manipulate the press, I think, are very dangerous. And I'm very worried about the statements that President Trump has made with that respect and about his overt efforts to manipulate the media in the United States.
No one has any clue what the foreign policy of this administration is. There was head scratching in this hall when the vice president sat here and talked about our common values. Literally 2 days after the president of the United States opened up a full frontal assault on the free press. I hope that this administration gets its act together very quickly. The United States Congress, which has largely taken itself out of the game on foreign relations over the past 2 decades, doesn't have to any longer. And if we're really serious about this transatlantic connection, the values that underlie it, then we can say something about it in the United States Congress.
Countries in the Persian Gulf region need to surmount the current state of division and tension and instead move in the direction of erecting realistic regional arrangements. It can perhaps start with a modest regional dialogue forum based on generally recognized principles and shared objectives.
If you ask me what is the biggest news in the Middle East, I think that the first time since 48 that moderate Arab world, Sunni world, they understand that the biggest threat for them, it's not Israel, not Jews, and not Zionism, but Iran and Iranian proxy.
Iran remains the single most, the biggest state sponsor of terrorism in the world. The Iranians are the only country in the region that has not been attacked by either Daesh or Al-Qaeda. And this begs the question, why?
Iran is trying to make Syria and Iraq a Shia, two Shia states, which is also very dangerous.
War crimes, I'm afraid, have become the status quo in Syria. Assad must go, and this is not a slogan. This is a practical reality.
I think a lot of people have a problem seeing Bashar al-Assad as a normal guy. Given the atrocities in Syria over the last 6 years.
Sorry, but I believe that this is just for the people of Syria to take this position, whether they like or dislike Bashar Assad. It's not our case to take a position on that, I believe.
What happened in eastern Aleppo easily could be replicated in eastern Ghouta or in Idlib. You know, this strategy of starve and bomb the people into submission is the strategy of Assad, and they're going to pursue this if this, you know, ceasefire, unless you're trying to feed somebody, breaks down.
Where is the U.S. in all this? Well, I can't tell you because I don't know.
Thank you so much, all of you, for what I thought was a really important Munich Security Conference at a difficult moment in transatlantic history. Thank you very much. Get home safely.